Welcome, friends. Greetings from the breaking grounds, taking roots. The Istanbul Principles at 7, a potentially game-changing meeting of hundreds of civil society champions from around the world, along with some government representatives and other partners, happening currently in Bangkok, Thailand. CNS Managing Editor Shubha Shukla spoke with Azra Saeed, who leads Roots for Equity in Pakistan. She has contributed significantly on championing causes of small and landless farmers, both men and women. Azra Saeed is also the chair of International Women's Alliance, a global network of grassroots women. Without any further ado, let's listen to Azra Saeed of Roots for Equity in conversation with Shubha from CNS.
Istanbul Principles being helpful in the past 7 years for increasing effectiveness and accountability of CSOs as development actors.
I have critique of the SDGs as they are. But the context of sustainable development is really people's development, you know, and the planet's development. Both of them are together. And the context of Istanbul Principles is accountability to the people, right? And if you look at the development justice paradigm, which is the people's paradigm for sustainable development, that also has accountability as the most critical pillar. Of the five pillars, accountability to me, that's how we read it, that if there is no accountability, there is no development. So there can only be, economic justice, environmental justice, gender justice, if there is accountability. So I think the main context of Istanbul Principles is accountability of the people to the people. And I think that popularizing that sentiment that we also as actors of change have to be accountable was there. I think in the people's movement it was there. The people's movement, the social movements, the grassroots movements have always held themselves accountable. I think for the larger CSOs, the international CSOs, it's something which has given them food for thought.
What have been the challenges that we have confronted in implementing the Istanbul Principles over the last 7 years?
One has to be very careful of Istanbul Principles in the context of the southern governments. Because the southern governments see this as a tool, as a whipping tool for civil society. The past, since 9/11, I think, the world scenario has changed drastically. And things have become very difficult. Any kind of accountability of the government that you ask for results in you being labeled. In the context of my country, we have people, farmers, who may be trying to occupy land. What do you do? Do you say it's wrong to occupy land? You know, sometimes they're trying to resist government evicting them from land. Even then, it's a very, very sensitive issue. And land grab is just going, it's becoming like a tsunami, you know, in all our countries, because there is a need for land for development, for these gentrification, residential colonies, for very posh buildings and so on, highways, you know, infrastructure of dams, everything apart from the free economic zones, of course.
How do you envision redefinition of accountability and effectiveness of all actors in development cooperation?
It's very needful for the big NGOs and civil societies who are taking money from the World Bank or money from like the US aid, you know, the American aid agency, which also has a big hand in pushing the public-private partnership, which is very anti-people. So there are billions of dollars that is coming to these very large NGOs. Many of the NGOs are now like clearing houses for ODA. So yes, accountability of those people, from where that money is coming and for what purpose is that coming, and can we call that development? We need to redefine who is the World Bank. We need to restructure, or we maybe need to dismantle the World Bank and the IMF, the WTO. So of course, and they consider themselves the biggest players in development. I was just talking to a minister of the Philippine government. You know, there are many who have gone from the left into the government in the Philippines, and that person was telling me how billions of dollars are there in the government, which are billions of pesos which are there in the government, which can be used for very effective use of people's development. And she was saying that in the previous years, even like trying to find 1,000 pesos was such a big problem, and the government has so much money. So yes, most CSOs who are really striving to bring about sustainable change, you know, for them, money is very hard to get. So we see that the whole issue of accountability is used as a stick for those who really want to serve the people, and organizations who are there, who are willing to bring in the neoliberal policy framework. Money for them is not a problem, but we, at least, I think CPTE believes very is grounded in the context that aid has to be accountable. So for us to be accountable is we are happy to be accountable. It's a pillar for us to be accountable, and there are many shades of being accountable apart from money.
Exactly, I was going.
There is accountability
that.
Of the work we do,
exactly.
of the messages that we bring. To, as you said, to our state functionaries, to the people, to our academics, you know, to our journalists, to the media. We are accountable in many ways. How are we spending our hours, you know? I think if we really want to apply the Istanbul principles, if it has to be effective, then this needs to be applied to the big CSOs who are clearing houses for now for ODA money. We also need to think in terms of sensitive issues which are there with respect to people's movements and social movements, because they are sometimes very vulnerable.
Yes. Civil society space shrinking, and how can Istanbul principles be helpful and useful in helping safeguard this civil society space?
It has shrunk immensely, especially in the farmers movement, in the grassroots. There's no money going now to migrant work, to landless farmers, to women, especially fisher folk women or agriculture women, and all of that arena is being taken over by the private sector. International Standard for Classification of Occupations clearly says that skilled labor starts from primary education, and primary education is 5 years of education. Now, how many women in the rural sector will have 5 years of schooling? So that means that millions and millions of women across South Asia, only in South Asia, are now pushed into being unskilled, unrecognized labor, informal labor. So they will work from 12 hours to more. They get hardly paid for harvesting wheat per day. Do you know they get 2.5 kilograms of wheat per day for 8 to 10 hours of just backbreaking work? And you know, harvesting wheat is done when it is very hot. We know that it only wheat is ready for being harvested when it is very hot. And if you, I'm sure you've been to the fields and you know what it is. If you're bending and you're cutting and you're cutting, and you know, as they cut, the spikes of the harvested stalks are on the ground. So they're walking over that. If you look at their feet, they're bleeding. You know, because some of them don't have footwear, or if they have footwear, they don't want to destroy it. So they prefer not to wear it while they're working. And so there is no recognition by the government that these women are being just killed for bringing food to the tables of the rich and the elite, with no food on their tables themselves, you know. And so where is the money to say that these women need to be recognized as labor, as dignified labor, being given decent wages? First of all, the CSOs don't have that kind of money to do that. Then the security issues are such that many of the women who can go work with these women are not allowed by their families to leave and go and work in rural areas. There's no attention being paid to these issues. Huh? But if we speak out and say that these women are being brutalized, we are working against government interest. So in terms of shrinking spaces, yes, for the most critical areas, they don't want us to be working on it. On the other hand, the private sector is now the, you know, the torch carrier.
They are allowed because of the profits.
And then the big CSOs who have World Bank money and IMF money and USAID money redefine what is people's rights.
So how do you think, in what ways can the Istanbul principles help CSOs and governments to act as development actors and achieve Agenda 2030 or the SDGs, which to a large extent promote what Istanbul principles have been promoted earlier?
I think democratic ownership today, there's a workshop on democratic ownership, is things like that, you know, where we look at something like democratic ownership and say that democratic ownership is only possible when people work in an enabled environment, right? So it helps us to, when we have to talk about it, we are able to give out those messages of account. For instance, if I'm asked to do something on accountability, to me it is accountability to the people, right? And how can I be accountable to the people when the government is calling me a terrorist? So it just keeps on going back to the enabling environment. I think they're so closely tied. I really want those farmers not to be evicted. You know, my organization and the people, the mass movement, we work with a mass movement called the Pakistan Kisan Mazdoor Tehreek. We really work very hard to project that there's so many thousands of farmers in my country are being evicted. But every time we have a rally or something, the government does not give us permission. We go and stand, we get, we literally, we will have more police than us surrounding us. Farmers who have come to the road have more than 300 FIRs, which is the first police report, information report, against them. Or sometimes it has happened that we have arranged a big rally and there is a bomb attack somewhere else. And in the name of security, the rally cannot be held. And in any case, if there are so many people who are dead, you know, you are already in mourning. How can you have a rally which will be disrespectful to the people who have been killed and their families? So, you know, if I'm accountable, I can't hold a rally. Not because the government is telling me not to, but because, yes, there are other people who are suffering. So all of these are the word accountability, democratic ownership, environmental justice are all words which are attached to the realm of enabling environment. And so it helps us to connect these two. It helps us to bring it out very clearly that it's not only about being accountable to the government, we have to be accountable to ourselves. But how are we accountable to ourselves if the surrounding environment is so anti-people? So it just highlights the issue in a different way, which I think is very useful.
Thank you very much, Azrazi. Anything, any message you would like to give or anything else you would like to share?
I think that we live in very difficult times. Militarization is so high now on every government's agenda. And instead of pouring money into military aid to our governments or only using it against the people, I think there is a real need to put that money into the people, into self-actualization of empowerment and development, you know. And this is what will save us. Otherwise, the environment is falling down on our heads and people's poverty is escalating. Thank you so much.
We were listening to Azra Saeed, who leads Roots for Equity in Pakistan. She has contributed significantly on championing causes of small and landless farmers, both men and women. Azra Saeed is also the chair of International Women's Alliance, a global network of grassroots women. She was in conversation with CNS Managing Editor Shobha Shukla. For more details, be welcome to check out CPDE website, www.csopartnership.org. Thanks for listening and stay tuned.